I will start with evolutionary medicine. What is evolutionary medicine? It's a field that where evolution, evolutionary theory help us to explain many health and disease issues, and it's a very hot issue today in evolution. Okay, the founders of evolutionary medicine is George William and Stephen Stearns, a professor out of NESET that developed this field, and we owe to them the development of this field, so they help to understand better the mechanism of many diseases through the evolutionary theory. Evolutionary Medicine and Public Health is a journal that is dedicated to evolutionary medicine, and it publishes every month very interesting papers about evolutionary medicine, and it has a great impact factor, actually, 4.4. I had the honor to be the guest editor of a special issue on evolutionary medicine last year in in Journal of Molecular Evolution. And you can find this issue, you can find very interesting articles about evolutionary medicine. Now, what about evolution and cancer? Everybody knows today that cancer can be explained by evolutionary theory. You can continue, please, to the next slide. And evolutionary theory can explain many issues of cancer, like clonal evolution and progression of mutations and metastasis. But what about individuals and populations? Can you use evolutionary theory to explain the high cancer incidence in humans today? A few years ago, I have hypotheses. I hypothesized that genetic variants that have been selected at the past for survival in certain environmental conditions may predispose for cancer later on age. What are the most extreme environmental conditions that humans had adapted to? Cold and high altitude. So, this that I did, I analyzed the genes that have been found to be under selection in cold and high altitude, and I compare these genes with genes that have been associated with cancer. Actually, these populations that live in very cold and high altitude environments have also very high incidence of cancer today. So, according to my analysis, I found that cancer genes that cancer-associated genes are also genes that are under selection. So, a significant number of genes under selection are also cancer-associated genes. And this is very statistically significant. Most of the cancer genes and under selection are tumor suppressor genes. And actually, some papers that have been published recently in PNAS show that certain amino acids in p53 gene help some mammals to survive on high altitude. There is also a fact that we know a lot of years now that some genes that are homologue of tumor suppression genes in bacteria and protozoa, when they are mutated, help them to survive under extreme conditions like starvation and antibiotics. So all these are in accordance with my results. I found also that association of cancer with cold is a wider phenomenon in human populations. I found by linear regression that the colder the country, the higher the cancer incidence. And this is very interesting that it shows that very probably the populations that survive under extreme cold, they also have high cancer incidence today. This has been published in Molecular Biology and Evolution. A recent study in the United States showed the same result, that geographic areas in the United States with low temperature have also very high cancer incidence. I published a small commentary article that I discuss also that Scandinavian countries that have very low temperatures have also high cancer incidence. And all these agrees with antagonistic pleiotropy hypothesis for George Williams. Antagonistic pleiotropy of George Williams' theory says that mutations that have been selected in certain environments to survive at the past today cause disease later on age. I discussed all this in a recent review I published in Journal of Molecular Evolution, where I show many examples that have been published regarding antagonistic pleiotropy. Other explanations exist why cold is associated with cancer, but I believe that evolutionary theory is the most possible one. Another recent study of my group showed that cancer and suicide attempt have a common genetic link. Our observation was that in Greenland, populations in Greenland have the highest cancer incidence today and the highest suicide attempt today. So when we analyzed the genes that are associated with cancer and suicide attempt, we found that many of these genes are in common. We also showed that in many countries that have very cold temperatures, suicide and cancer are very frequent. And this is very significant under a linear regression analysis. Now, have ongoing genes and tumor suppression genes have a special role in evolution? This is another question. There are a number of papers that recently have been published and show the significance of cancer genes in evolution. Among these papers is one of Professor Kozlov's paper that shows that ongoing and tumor suppression genes are the oldest human gene classes and evolve concurrently. There are also a number of papers that show why cancer is so rare in certain species. For example, elephants have 23 copies, and this protects them from cancer. Dolphins and whales have gene duplications that are involved in apoptosis and tumor suppression. And naked moles, mammals, have also a high number of tumor suppression gene duplications that protect them from cancer. Another recent paper from Professor Carlo Malley group showed that duplications of human cancer genes in many mammals associated with lifespan. A recent paper of my team showed that certain DNA repair genes are associated with evolutionary rate aside from genomes. We analyze 44 vertebrate genomes and we compare species that evolve rapidly and species that evolve very slowly. And we found that species that have that are evolving very rapidly have statistically more DNA repair genes than living fossil species, than species that evolve very slowly. So DNA repair genes probably are very important for evolution rate. Additionally, we found that more DNA repair genes are found in larger genomes. I also published an interesting hypothesis showing that populations that survive in extreme environments, probably they have more mutation load in DNA repair genes. But unfortunately, this causes cancer in later years when adaptation is most normal. I'm currently working with zebrafish. I'm trying to further these theories through zebrafish experiments. And I'm experimenting with zebrafish that are mutated in tumor suppressor genes. And I'm trying to see if these zebrafish are more resistant under extreme environmental conditions like cold starvation. I have some promising results until now, but I need more work to show this. We have a zebrafish facility here in our medical school. I'm experimenting with zebrafish larvae, zebrafish plates in 96 plates, and I've tried these plates in different laboratory conditions. So now I summarize my the conclusions of my presentation. I think that high cancer frequency or low cancer frequency in different species is probably related with their evolution history. Cancer could be a side effect of evolution, at least partially. Cancer genes, especially tumor suppression genes, seem to have played an important role on evolution of multiple species. But more research is needed to decipher more clearly the contribution of cancer genes to evolutionary fitness. I believe that the quote of Theodosius Dobzhansky, "Nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution," is very valid for cancer and evolution. Thank you for your attention.